Hi everyone, so today we'll talk about object-oriented programming, object-oriented thinking in general. But before the class starts, I want to tell you something about some of the questions that were asked on Piazza. So one question that was asked on Piazza was, what is the difference between public and private keywords? And the second one, what does static mean? So basically, private means that the field or method is not available outside the class itself. The opposite of that is public visibility modifier, which means that the field is available outside the class, anywhere in any package, in any other class. There is one other visibility modifier that is between private and public, which is protected, which we'll talk about a little bit later when we talk about inheritance. And there is another one called default. Default is when you don't have private, public, or protected. So default means that a field or a method that is not modified by private, public, or protected, it's available to any class in the same package. So it's package modified. Default, it means that is available to other classes in the same package. Private is, again, the opposite end. That means that is not available anywhere else except outside, except the class itself. Public means that is available anywhere outside the class. Now let's talk about static. So static means that is not a property of an individual object. It's a property of the class. For instance, a static method can be accessed without an object of the class first. So here I have an example. I have a class main. I have a static method. It's a static method, which prints out static methods can be called without creating objects. Basically, it's like the math.power method. You call it with parameters and it does the power of one parameter to the other. Now here is a non-static method, my public non-static method, which must be invoked because it's a non-static method, must be invoked for a specific object. Okay. So now I have a main method, public static void main, that calls my static method without having to specify an object for it. I could call it with main.myStatic method. Main is the name of the class. I can also call it as my static method because I am in the same class. And you can invoke it and it will print this statement. If you try to call the non-static method, my public method, you will get an error. Basically, it will tell you it's a syntactic error telling you that this is an instance method. You cannot call it without an object. In order to call it, you need an object of this main class, the class that I'm basically creating here. And for that specific object, you can invoke the public this public instance method. So that's the difference between static versus non-static for methods. Static methods, you can invoke them without an object and just with the class itself. And instance methods, those are the non-static methods. You must invoke them for an object with this dot operator. You have to create an object of that class and then you can invoke that method. I gave you another example. So in this example, there are two data fields which are non-static. There is no static keyword in these two data fields. And then there is one data field that is static, number of cars. So one thing that you can see here is that in the constructor of this class, I'm initializing the two data fields for the current object. This.name is name, this.engine is engine. And I'm incrementing with one, the static data field number of cars. So what this basically does, every object of this class gets initialized and the same copy, the class static variable number of cars is incremented with one. So this is kind of like a counter attached to the class itself that counts how many instances of this class were created. So in again, in a main method, I can create multiple cars, Jaguar, Bugatti, and so on with different engines. And then I can print out for this class car, how many number cars were produced. This is a variable number of cars, is a static variable, a class variable, and it will give me how many objects of that class were created. So there are a bunch of key points to remember. First of all, about methods. Static methods cannot use this or super keyword that we will talk about next class. So you can't use this for static methods. Static methods cannot access instances or instance methods directly. They need some object reference to do so. Static variables belong to the class itself. They can be accessed with using the class name, like we did for car.number of cars, and don't need any reference object. One question that I see in the chat from Richard is, how is public static int from primitive ints? Like int li is equal with zero, public static int versus just non-static ints. Okay, I think I understand the question. So let's say that in this test method, in this test class, I have an int I is equal with one, and I have a static int k is equal with one, two, okay? So how can I use k and how can I use I? So for k, I basically don't need much. I can just do system.out.println. And I can just put k, or I can put the name of the class test.k. So that's totally fine because this is a static method. This is a static data field. I can increment k. I can assign a different value to k and so on. So it's totally fine because I'm using the k that is in this class in a static method. From a different class, I can still use k if that class would be in the same package. Now, what about I? I can only use it for specific objects. So for instance, if I create a test T1 object as a new test class, I remember from last class, we said that if a class doesn't have a constructor, it will have the default constructor by default. That's why it's called a default constructor. So now for this T1, I can do system.out.println T1.i. And similarly, I can do basically for this same I can increment it for T1. I can do T1.i is equal with 3. And this is different than another T. So for instance, if I have another T test object, so I have T2 has its own I. So basically, I can use the default, which was one, and then it will print t2.i is one. So this will basically print that t1's i data field is three because we just assigned it above. And in this case is the initial value of i, t2.i is one. So each one of these objects of the type t has its own I variable. As opposed to k, which is one for the entire class. And I believe that responds to your question. Good. Okay. Good. So that basically responds to that question. It was a very good question about static versus non-static, private versus public. Okay, good. So now we can continue with thinking in objects. Stop me at any time if you have any questions, okay? So before we actually talk about classes, Let me refresh what we discussed about last class. So last class, we learned the fact that beside being a program, a class in Java is also a pattern to create objects of that class. So we learned that we can define a class, for instance, circle with multiple data fields, for instance, private double radius, and then maybe other data fields, private string color. These classes have a certain type of methods called constructors. Public circle with no parameters gets default values for the radius and the color. Maybe we have public circle, which takes the double radius as a parameter, and it creates a circle for that radius. So for the current object, radius is assigned the radius formal parameter. Now, since these data fields are private, I will also allow one to actually get them with accessor methods. So public double get radius that returns the radius of the circle. There is another type of methods. Yes, you can also set default values. You can assign this to one and maybe the circles to red. There is the modifier method, public void set radius. That takes a double. In this case, let's call it also radius. And what we did last time, we only set for those radiuses that are positive. So if the radius is greater than zero, then we set this dot radius to radius. Otherwise, we just ignore it. Okay. Now we have a class. In another class, or even in the same class, we can have a main method in which we use that class above. So let's use it in another class. So maybe we have a class test. In this class, we have a main method. So in this main method takes arguments as parameters. And now we can create a circle. C1 is a new circle with a radius of 2. And maybe another circle, circle C2, which is a new circle of radius of 5, and so on. Now, let's say that I want to get its radius, each one's of them's radius. So system print ln, and now I can print c1.getRadius. And similarly, I can print C2's radius. Because each one of them has a different radius. Okay. So what do we see in the main method? We see that basically we can initialize objects of the class above using the constructor. So basically we can use circle to create a new circle of that given radius. So when we initialize an object, it's a little bit different than when we initialize primitive type variables. So before we talked about classes, we said that Java has two categories of types. And one type of types was primitive types. And that includes, basically there are four integer types. There are two real types, real numbers. Then there are, and let me enumerate them. So integer types were byte, short, int, and long. And then there were the two real number types, float and double. And then there was char for storing a single character within single quotes, and boolean. And for all of them, we can only write basically a variable like int I is equal with one. The second category of types are objects or reference types. Reference types are basically any one of these objects that we have above, like circle C1. And instead of using like C1 equal with something, we write C1 equal with new, and then the constructor of that class. So new circle of radius of one. It's the same that we did when we talked about scanner. We said scanner input is a new scanner for the system input stream. Okay. So you see, we use the same new operator to create an object of that type. Okay? And similar, we can have strings. So we have string S1. It's a new string that has some string in it, like hi. Now, strings are a little bit special because we can also write string S1 is equal with hi. But really, this is a shortcut. So strings are special. It's a special case because strings are very popular, and we don't want to overload the developer to write for every single string, new string, and the string. It's also accepted that strings can be put within double quotes. So it's a special case of objects. And in fact, they are stored differently. So for strings like this one, they are actually stored in the static segment of memory. And for strings like the one above that I create with the new operator, they are stored in the heap, which are basically the dynamic segment of memory. So they are a little bit different. I will talk more about strings during the lecture today. Other reference types, the ones that we discussed last class, we can create a date, for instance, for the current time, it's a new date. I can create a random object, random R1, it's a new random for a seed that is given. This is in the lecture notes for last class. You can take a look there. Okay. So today we continue with reference types, with object types. So we remember what we talked about last class, basically that we can create classes and we can instantiate them as objects later. And now we can basically continue with other issues. Okay. Any questions with what I remind you summarized from last
time? Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please do so.
So there a constructor, we have like this dot radius equal radius, and still we have the set radius, and we have a condition if radius larger than zero. So which one will implement first or something?
Can you repeat the question? I don't think I got it.
Yeah, we have the constructor circle, right? And the we have this dot radius equal radius.
Okay.
And then we have the set radius.
Okay, that's a different method. Yeah. Each one of these, it's a different method.
But here we have like two this radius dot radius equal radius. So which one will implement first?
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
The order of constructors or methods, the methods and constructors can be in any possible order. So I can have this public constructor later. In fact, I can have these data fields later. I can have them at the end of the class. So the order doesn't matter. It's basically the scope of a data field is the entire class. Similarly, the scope of a method is the entire class. So it doesn't matter that they are defined at the end. I can still use them in instance methods.
Okay. Sure, I got it. Thank you.
Welcome. But it's a very good question. It's actually part of the lecture today. Okay, good. So let's talk about the first issue, immutable classes. Okay. And I will give you this example that I have here, but I will take out the set method. So the radius is private. There are two constructors and there is an accessor. So one thing that you can observe about this circle is that once a circle is created, like for instance, in the main method, I created a circle with radius of 2. There is no method or any way that I can change the radius of that circle. So if a circle is created and there is no, the data fields are private, all the data fields are private, and there are no set methods or mutators, then that object is an immutable object. So a class with all the data fields private and without mutators is immutable. So immutable basically is that the content of the object cannot be changed once the object is created. Its class is called an immutable class. For example, in this circle class that I created here, the data field radius is private. And there is no set method. There is only a get method that returns basically a copy of the radius, that double radius. Since the radius is private and there is no set method, then it cannot be changed. So any object that is created of this class is what is called an immutable object. The content cannot be changed once the object is created. Okay, that's an immutable class. Okay. There are some questions in the chat that I missed. So oh, not a question. Okay, good. Okay, good. So there are immutable classes and objects. Now, what are the properties for a class to be immutable? So the first thing that one would say, the data fields are private and there are no set methods. But that's not quite enough for a class to be immutable. A class with all the data fields private and without mutators is not necessarily immutable because we can have an accessor that returns a reference. And that reference can be to a mutable object. So a true immutable class, it must mark all the data fields private. It should provide no mutator methods, no set methods, but also no accessors that would return a reference to a mutable data field. So let me show you an example. So we have here the class student. The class student has two private data fields, the integer ID and the private birth date of the type birth date of the type birth date. We have a constructor, the student that takes an SSN as the ID, the year, the month, and the day, and assigns the SSN to the ID of that class data field. And a new object of the type birth date, which is the class to the right, with the year, month, and day. We have a constructor that takes three integers and it creates such an object. We only have accessors for this method. We have the get ID method and we have the get birth date method. So they return the ID and the reference to the birth date. The birthday class, so one thing that you can observe about student, by the way, is the fact that all the data fields are private and there are only accessors, there are no mutators. But that doesn't make it immutable. In fact, it's still mutable. And the reason for that is that it returns a reference to a birth date. The birth date type class is to the right. It has a private integer year, an integer month and day. These are all private integers. It has a constructor for the birth date that basically given the new year, the new month and the new day, assigns each of them to the corresponding data fields, year, month and day. And the set year method, which takes a new year, it's a mutator, and assigns the new year to the year data field. Get year basically gets the year of that specific, of that data field. Now look at the test class. It has a main method in which I create a new student with the ID 111, two twos and three and four threes, 1998, January 1st. The date of the student, I can get it with basically student.getBirthDate. And I can actually set the date, birth date, year of the student to a different date, like 2050. Now the student's birth year has changed. If I print student.getBirthDate.getYear, it will tell me that is 2050. So obviously it's not an immutable object, because the student was created as having the birth year 1998, but now it tells me that the birth year for that student is 2050. Okay. I don't actually need to get a new variable, so I could have written the two lines that I have here as only one line. I could have just said student.getBirthDate.setYear. Set year to 2050. Okay. So basically, I can change the year of the student, although the class student doesn't have mutators. It only has private variables and accessors. But the problem is that one of the accessors returns a reference to a mutable data field. What's the purpose? As an example, the purpose is that these two lines can be replaced by only one line that basically says that I can get the birth date for the student and set the year to 2050. So it's just, yeah. So it's not immutable. Okay. So that's why I said that for a true immutable class, all the data fields must be private, no mutator methods, and provide no accessors to mutable data fields. Good. Now, let's talk about data fields. So there are differences between data fields and local variables defined in methods. Data fields can be declared anywhere inside the class. The scope of the data field is the entire class. Okay. Also, data fields are initialized with default values. So let me show you an example. So let me get here. So I can have a data field integer I. This data field can be defined at the end of the class. So the order doesn't matter. I can still create an object of the type of the class and initialize that data field basically syntactically before it was defined to a different value, which basically works and prints out three. I can also invoke methods for this class. I can invoke print I. Okay. And this can be defined before the data field I is actually defined. So I can have public. I don't even need public. I just need void print I. And now I print I that is defined below. Again, no error whatsoever. It prints out the value of I. it's one at this point after I created the object, and then I initialize it to three and I print the value of I, which is three. So basically the point here is that data fields, although they are defined later, they are available anywhere in the class. One question is, why don't we define it as public, any one of these? Because I'm using it in the same class. So it doesn't matter, I can define it as public. If I want to use it somewhere else, I would define it as public and everything is fine, okay? I can also define it as private, as a matter of fact, because I'm only using it in this one class, the class test. So this is exactly the same as before, okay? One and three. Okay, and this is different than local variables. So local variables, by the way, one more thing. I also don't need to initialize data fields. So I can define it, and by default, the value of that data field is zero. So when I print it for the first time, it prints zero. Okay. So that's two differences between local variables and data fields. Data fields can be defined later and they get default values. Local variables, for instance, if I try here to print system.out println k, but k is only defined later, it will tell me that no, you can't print k because k is not yet defined. If I move this up here, now it will tell me that you can't print k because it's not initialized. So I need also to give it some value, like for instance, zero. So that's the two differences between local data fields and local variables. So data fields, the scope is the entire class and they are initialized with default values. Local variables, those variables defined inside methods, they are only available from their declaration up to the end of the block that contain that variable. And also local variable must be initialized before it can be used. So that's the two differences between data fields and local variables. Data fields can be declared anywhere and they are available in the same class, in the entire class. Local variables must be declared before they are used. Data fields are initialized with default values. Local variables must be initialized before they are used. Any questions? Okay. Now the this keyword. So this is a word, a reserved word that is a reference to the object itself. So when we have a instance method, we can use this to access a data field. Common uses of the this keyword is the fact that you can access the data fields that are hidden in the current method, usually because there is a local variable with the same name. So, but it's also optional that you can actually use this keyword even if there is no local variable with the same name. This is just a name for the current object. Also, the this keyword can be used to invoke another constructor of the same class. So if I have another constructor of the same class and I have some code in that constructor that I don't want to duplicate in another constructor, I can call from one constructor the other constructor as the first statement of that constructor. So you can't have it later. It has to be the first statement, this open parentheses, and then the arguments that you want to use, but you call it, instead of calling the name of the class, you use this to invoke another constructor. So Omar is asking a question that is, wouldn't it be better to just use a global variable so you don't have to worry if it's after or before it's being used? Java doesn't have such global variables. Basically, global variables, the only thing that I could think about global variables are static variables. They are not about for an individual object like t.i, and you may have multiple t's. So I assume that by global variable, you actually mean static variables, like static integer j. But in that case, if you want two different i's, two different variables that for are different for two objects, t1.i and t2.i, those are different and you want them as different. Basically, the variable I, in this case is actually zero, is different because, like for instance, it's, let's say the radius of one circle is different than the radius of another circle. So it's not like you have a global variable that you want to use for every single case. You have two different variables that are representing two radiuses. Okay, Ming-Xi is saying that global may mean maybe from Python. I wrote Python programs and I don't remember a keyword global. I would assume that it's basically similar. Okay, there are basically variables defined in the user space. Like you would define some variable I equal with 10 in the user space. Java doesn't have such a thing. Okay. So Java, equivalent of global variables in Python would be static data fields in Java. Okay. Okay, good. So let's see the this keyword. So here I have a class foo, which defines two variables, private integer I equal with 5 and private static double k equal with 0. In the method set I is an instance method, I have a local parameter int I, a formal parameter, and I want to use that value of that I to initialize the field I of the class foo, of an object of the class foo. So for that, I assign to this.i the value of I. If I would have just written I equal with I would have assigned to I the formal parameter I itself. So that's not actually setting the private data field I, okay? So this is one use of the this keyword. Basically, I use this.i to specify that if set of I is invoked for two different objects of the class foo, f1.set I to 10, and f2.seti to 45, this.i means basically the I parameter of f1 and the I parameter of f2. So basically there are two different data fields, okay? So this in both cases represents the current object. Another method for the static double k variable, set k, can initialize again, I get double k as a formal parameter. And again, if I want to assign it to k, I have to use it foo.k is equal with k. Basically, I precede the static data field with the name of the class foo in this case. Okay. So that's basically the use of this keyword for accessing the data field that is hidden. Here I have another example. I define the public class circle with a double radius. The constructor for circle that takes a double radius, it assigns to the data field radius using this dot radius. This must be explicit in this case because we want the data field radius to be assigned the value of the formal parameter radius. So this is actually necessary in this case if we want to assign to the radius the data field the formal parameter radius value. Now another use of this is to call another constructor. So for instance, here I want to create a circle of a radius of 1, and I don't want to write this dot radius is equal with 1. I want to actually don't duplicate that line I call the other constructor. So this, in the second case, is used to invoke another constructor of the same class. So you see, instead of using the name of the class, like circle of one, in Java, we use this to call another constructor, call the other constructor with the value 1.0. Okay. I can also use this in a method that doesn't have other variables, because this every instance of this is the current object. So the radius data field of the current object is multiplied with the radius data field is multiplied with math.py. So it's basically this represents a reference to the current object. Any questions? Good. Now, since the class has all the set of all the public methods signatures, the creator of the class provides a description of the class through the signatures of all the public methods and public constants. For a user, the user doesn't care how the class is implemented, as long as it's encapsulated, all the data fields are private, and we have the signatures of all the public methods and public constants. This is called encapsulation, method abstraction, that basically the data fields of the class are private, and the class can only be instantiated and changed using the data fields or the public methods of that class. This in Java is called encapsulation. The clients do not care how the class is implemented. To them, it's like a black box. They only care about what are the signatures of all of the public methods, so they can invoke those methods, like constructors, accessors, mutators, and other instance methods. Yeah, black box is the same idea of basically black boxes in planes, that as long as you have an interface to collect out the data out of it, it can be implemented in any possible way. So let's see a bunch of examples. So I will start with an example of a loan. So for instance, during the pandemic, I bought a house. I had to make a loan to a bank. The bank basically has a system that manages multiple loan objects. So they manage my mortgage and somebody else's mortgage. Every loan has a set of internal data fields, annual interest rate, number of years, how many years you have that loan, the loan amount, and the loan date. So basically, these are internal data fields. In order to create a loan, I can create a loan with the default values. So for instance, for $1,000 for 1 year at 2.5% annual interest rate, I can create a loan for the current date. So there are multiple constructors. The default constructor creates a loan for that amount. There is the constructor that takes the annual interest rate, number of years, and loan amount, and creates a loan object for that specific values. I have accessor methods. Those are the get methods. I can get the annual interest rate, the number of years as an integer, the loan amount as a double, and the loan date as a date object. And I have mutators, set methods that basically you can set the annual interest rate to a different double value, the number of years to a different integer value, and the loan amount to a different double value. And I have two more public methods. Plus symbolizes public in the UML diagram, while minus symbolizes private. So the other two public methods are get monthly payment for a loan. You want to get how much you have to pay every month, and get total payment for a loan. You want to get what's the total payment after you basically pay all of the months, with not only with the original amount and the interest rate, but also compounded interest. I don't know if you know, but for instance, it said that for a mortgage, you usually pay double the price of the house, because you compound during the first few years. Most of your payments are actually just you're paying the interest, for the period of time. You're not actually paying the original, the amount that you are you're owning. So that's basically the loan class. And here is the implementation of the loan class. So basically I have the private data fields, double annual interest rate, integer number of years, double loan amount, and the date. And I have two constructors. Let's look at the second constructor first. It takes a double, an integer, and a double, annual interest rate, number of years, and loan amount, and assigns each one of those formal parameters to the corresponding data field. So you see, I use this dot annual interest rate, which is the annual interest rate data field, is assigned the annual interest rate formal parameter. This dot number of years, the number of years data field is assigned the number of years formal parameter. And the loan amount data field of the current object, this again refers to the current object, is assigned the loan amount for data field. And finally, the loan date is a new instance of Java util date. I have methods to get the monthly payment and the total payment. These are not important because basically I'm not going to ask, but if you want, you can actually test them. There are methods that consider the compound interest and they compute the monthly payment over the entire period of time with compound interest. Okay. And similarly, the total payment is basically the monthly payment multiplied with the number of years multiplied with 12. Any questions? Okay. So another example. For instance, if I work at a gym, I want to compute the BMI for various members of the gym and make recommendations for the various members. So basically a BMI class may contain the data field's name for the name of the customer, age for the age of the customer, weight as the weight in pounds, and height as the height of the person in inches. The BMI body mass index is a formula based on the weight and the height, and also the age, but in our case, we only consider the weight and the height. They are actually computed for centimeters or meters per kilograms. So the first thing that we need to do is actually to change the weight and the height to the corresponding values for the weight in kilograms and the height in centimeters or meters. So I have two constructors, one constructor that takes all the data fields, name, age, weight, and height, and another one that takes the name, weight, and height and computes the BMI for a person with the default age of 20 years old. I have two more methods, getBMI that returns just the BMI value, and the getStatus that returns a string if the person is underweight, overweight, like me, or just normal. So here I have BMI. So the BMI class has the private string variable name, the private int age, the private double weight, the private double height. All of these are private data fields. Then I have two constants, public static final double kilograms per pound. It's a double constant. It's stored only once at the level of the class because it's static, and it's final. Final means that it's a constant, cannot be modified. Now, later, somebody cannot write kilograms per pound is equal with a different value. It's not that the kilogram is 0.45 pounds, is something else. A kilogram is 50 pounds, okay? So that's a constant. Basically, final means a constant. Static is the fact that is only stored once, okay? In the UML diagram, Yasir, you're totally right. We represent constants underlined. So, but unfortunately, Violet, the software that we are using for UML diagrams and also Draw does not allow one to underline things. So for instance, if you do want to represent a class with static data fields, Let's put circle, and I want radius to be a data field, and maybe now a static data field, static number of circles of the type integer. I basically just use static as a text saying that this data field is static. And similar for methods. So I have, let's say, a constructor for circle, maybe two constructors for circle, one that takes the radius as a double. And then I have maybe get radius that returns double. And I have static get number of circles that returns an integer. So again, I set static. So I can't underline it. I basically write it like static. Okay. Excellent. Good. Good. So let's return back to our BMI class. So I have a constructor that takes the, so I have the two constants, kilogram per pounds. So 1 kilogram is 0.45. Actually, it's the other way around. 1 pound is 0.45 kilograms, and 1 inch is 2.5 centimeters. More exactly is 0.0254 meters. And then I have a constructor, BMI, that takes the name, the age, the weight, and the height, and initializes the corresponding data fields. This dot name is equal with name. This dot age is equal with the age data field. This dot weight is equal with the weight data field, with the weight formal parameter. And this dot height is equal with the height. The BMI formula is computed below. Is the weight multiplied with kilograms per pounds. So basically it computes the weight in kilograms divided by the height multiplied with the meters per inch, multiplied with the height multiplied with meters per inch. It's basically the height square in meters. And then the BMI is basically this very value BMI multiplied with 100 divided by 100 and rounded. So that gives us the BMI. Now, the status method uses the get BMI method. So I get the BMI from that method. If the BMI is less than 16, then it's seriously underweight. If it's less than 18, then it's underweight. If it's less than 24 on the else branch, then it returns normal weight. Else, if the BMI is less than 29, returns overweight. This is what it returns for me, this class. And then it returns seriously overweight under 35 or gravely overweight over 35. So it's just an example of a class that, given the person, it returns the correct status and the correct BMI. Richard is asking a question. This dot age is equal with age. It's basically, these are four statements that I put in the same line, but basically I'm assigning the formal parameter to the corresponding data field. So I must use this to access the data field so I can assign the value of that formal parameter. They can be in one line because in Java, new spaces do not matter. I can put my entire program in one line. The reason why I put this one line, these four different statements in one line is so I can fit in the slide, the entire program. What if we wanted an input in this code? You can get it with a scanner like you would do in any other program. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Okay, good. Now, another example. Oh, by the way, any other questions about BMI class? So we did the loan class with the BMI class.
For example, if we wanted an input for name, would we put it under the public string get name?
Yes. Yeah. So, or set name, a public void set name, and then you would define a scanner. You would ask the user what's the name, and then you would write name equal input dot next line.
Okay, yeah. Mm.
Yep. Okay. So now the course class. So let's say that I want to represent my courses, all the students into objects. Yes, you can also have a main method to basically use. Yes, exactly like we did it for previous slides. So now, the course class contains the name of the class. It contains an array of strings as the students in that class and the number of students in that class as an integer. So basically, let's say that a class doesn't have more than 100 students. So students would be an array of 100 strings. And then for every string, adding a student takes a string and assigns to the next element in the array. This only works if the number of students is under 100 students. So let's work with that. If we need to make a bigger class, then we'll discuss that actually in the next class that we'll discuss, which is stacks. So here I have an example. Basically, I have the constructor course, which takes the name of the class, like CSC114. Then the get name returns the name of that class, the name data field. Add student takes a student and adds it to the array of students as the next element that is null. Get students returns the array of students with the first students initialized and then null values. And get number of students returns the value of number of students. So here is the implementation of the course class. I have a private data field string course name, an array of strings for the students, which I initialize with 100 students. I can make it 1,000 just to cover every possibility of classes. Then I can create a data field number of students, initially is initialized with 0. And then I create a course. So basically the course constructor takes the name of the course and initializes the name data field, course name data field with the course name formal parameter. Add student takes a string of a student name, like for instance, let's say Jim Smith, and students of number of students is assigned that student. So basically to that student, we assign to the first position that is available, we assign that student's name. And then I increment the number of students with 1. In fact, I could have put this as a post increment right here. And then I don't need this statement. So it's even shorter. So I have two things there. I have the fact that I'm assigning to students of number of students, which was 0 initially, the current student, and I'm incrementing the number of students with 1. Then get students returns the array of strings for names of students. Get number of students returns number of students data field, and get course name returns the course name. So I basically use the number of students both as the number of students in the array and as the index of that array. Good. Now, I do have a question about this class. So what if, how can I modify this class such that if I have more than 100 students, I still can add those students to the class. So any idea?
We have to increment the string students, like the index of it.
So what if I put more than 100 students? What if I already filled the 100 students and I call the add student method again? And Yasir responded in the chat, create a new array. So basically what I can do is excellent. If the number of students is greater than equal with the size of students array, then I can create, as Yasir said, a new array temp, and this array can be bigger, like a new string array, and it could be students dot length multiplied with 2. So I double the size of the array, and I can do it multiple times, and then I can copy the elements. I can use system dot array copy to copy the students from the original students from position 0 in temp from position 0, and the number of students that get copied are students dot length, and then redirect students to temp. So basically now I have a bigger array, and I can continue adding the next student to the array. So I don't really need to create an array and concatenate it with the old array. I can basically just create an array that is bigger than the old array, double the size, copy the students from the old array into the new array, and then redirect students to temp. And now I can use 200 students. And when I get to 200 students, the same method will check again and will say, oh, the number of students is greater than 200, the length of the array. Let me create an array of 400 students and copy the elements, redirect the array, and now I can add 400 students. And always when I get to this case, I duplicate the number of students. So I get, if I get 400 and I make an array of 800, if I get an array of, if I get 800, I make an array of 1,600, and it's unlimited, limited by the size of your main memory. Yeah, it doubles over and over. Yeah, excellent. So that's exactly the idea of the next class.
That's a good question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, in the previous one, what was the purpose of the 11th line, the array copy?
This one?
Yes.
So I need to copy the old students. So I'm not, it's not only that I create a new array, but I already have an array of 100 students. So I have Jim, John, Mary that are taking this class. I only want to add another student like Paul. So array.copy copies from the old array starting from position 0 into the new array temp starting from position 0, and how many elements students.length, the old array length.
Got it, thank you.
Mingxi is asking, how about the scope of a new array? I'm not quite sure that I understand. I mean, I'm still using the old reference arrays, which is a data field. So because that will be the reference of this temp. Temp is assigned to students. The old array was garbage collected. I didn't have to do anything with it. So the scope, if you are referring to the variable scope, which is basically the referencing environment in a program, it's still the old variable students. It's an instance variable for this course. I cannot use temp, but I don't need this variable anymore. This variable disappears the moment that I finish this, but only the variable disappears. So basically, I understand now what you're saying. So I defined two variables. So I have, let me actually draw this. This is a good point, very good point. So I have a string array students that was originally a new string array of 100 students. Then later, so later I create a new students, actually string array temp, which is a new string array of students dot length. Multiplied by 2. Okay. And later, again, after a bunch of lines, I'm assigning to students temp. And some block terminates. Okay. So what's happening? What internally, what's happening? Students was a reference to an array in memory that contained 100 students, okay? And we put in that array basically 100 students, big array of 100 students. Each of them is a reference to a string. Similarly, temp. So temp is basically a reference to an even bigger array. So this is also a reference to an array of 200 elements, actually double the size of the previous array. And we have an array copy that copies the elements, the corresponding elements from the old array to the new array. Okay. Then what we are doing, students, which was this reference, is assigned temp. So now students is pointing to this temp, okay? The old reference is lost. The moment that we finish the block, the temp is lost, but that's the reference. So students is still pointing to this array of 200 students. Students is equal with a new string of 100. Initially, when this line is executed, this array has 100 null references. So null, then null, and so on. So only later, when we add one student at a time, like with that add method, these references are now pointing to strings. So maybe this is a string that is Paul, this is a string that is Mary, and so on. Initially, they are all null. And when we do array copy, we are basically copying these references to the same references that to the same, we are copying the references from one array to another array. Okay. So now this actually takes us to the first data structure that we will learn in this class. And we have 10 minutes to understand it, which is stacks. So what is a stack? A stack is like a pyramid. You can only put objects on the top of the stack and takes objects from the top of the stack. Internally is represented by a private array of integers. This is a stack of integers. So we are using elements as an integer array to store the elements of the stack. The size is also a private variable of the type integer. That is the number of integers that we pushed in this stack. We put on top of this stack. We have two constructors, stack of integers, and stack of integers given a capacity, which is the initial capacity of the stack. Empty returns a Boolean. If the size of the stack is 0, then it returns true, otherwise it returns false. Peak returns the integer on the top of the stack, basically the element at index size, -1, and but doesn't delete it from the stack. It just tells you that on the top of the stack is the integer 5. Push puts the integer on the top of the stack. So the current element with index size is assigned the value of this value that is pushed into the stack, and the size is incremented with 1. So it's really like something that grows and then decreases as you pop elements from the stack. The pop method takes no parameters, and returns the value on the top of the stack and also decrements the size. So basically, it deletes the element from the stack. And get size just returns the size of the stack. So what does it mean, a stack? A stack is like you put on top of the objects that are in the stack, basically other objects, but always on top. And the best example that I can think of is once I bought a coffee at Starbucks in the library, in the Stony Brook library. And one thing that was happening at the time in that Starbucks, basically the cashier would write on a piece of paper and put it on top of each other, basically the orders. So we were three people in the line. I was the first. I ordered a coffee. Then somebody else ordered a cappuccino and somebody else ordered an ice cream. So basically my order was put in the stack. Then somebody's order was put on top of mine and somebody else's order was put on top of the previous order. The problem was that the barista in Starbucks would not take from the bottom of the stack like you would do in a queue, basically first in, first out. He would take on the top of the stack the order. So although I was the first one to order my coffee, I was patiently waiting for everybody else that was after me. Basically, this pile of orders was working like a stack. Basically, although I was the first one, I was the last one to get my coffee. I should have explained them the that this is a stack and this probably they should flip the orders and take from the bottom. Okay, it happens to all of us, unfortunately. So we shouldn't use a stack in a Starbucks. We should use probably a queue in a Starbucks. So basically, you take from the bottom the order, so you serve the next person. But I waited patiently for my coffee. I was thinking in my mind that if somebody else would come, I will be waiting there forever because basically everybody last in would be always the one that gets his order out. Yeah. So a stack is also called a last in, first out data structure. Basically, the idea is that although these objects were pushed into the stack data 1, 2, and 3, the first one to go out was 3, then 2, and then 1. Okay. Okay. So how would you implement a stack of integers? Basically, we use an array of integers. Initially, it's empty. The size initially was 0, but it increases as elements are pushed into the stack. The capacity of the stack is the original capacity of the stack, but again, it can be increased per need basis. So basically, in order to store a stack, we have an array of integers, elements, and an integer size, which basically is the current number of elements in the stack. By default is assigned 0. There is no element in the stack. Elements is not yet initialized to anything because I define a constant default capacity of 16 is a static final integer. And then I have two constructors. The default constructor, the empty no argument constructor, calls the other constructor this of default capacity, which takes an integer, the second constructor, and creates a new integer array of that capacity that was passed as a parameter and assigns the reference to that of that array to elements. So this is how we create a stack of integers as a new array of a given capacity. Then we have multiple methods. The push method. The push method checks exactly as I did it in my course class. If the size is greater than equal with the number of elements in the array, elements.length, the number of elements possible in the array, then the size is greater than number of elements, I create a new temporary array of double the size. So elements.length multiply with 2. And I copy the elements from the old array into the new array from index 0 in both arrays and the elements.length. And the elements is assigned the temporary reference. So basically, this doubles the size of the array and copies the elements from the old array to the new array. Now, elements of size plus plus can be assigned the value. So elements of size will be assigned the value, and the size is has a side effect of incrementing with 1. The pop method returns elements of minus minus size. So it decrements the size first, and then it returns the element at that index. And the pick method just returns elements of size minus 1. So it basically returns the element on the top of the stack, but it doesn't decrement the size with 1. It just computes the value and uses it as an index. And finally, the get size returns the size of the stack. There is one question. The size of the new array temp is larger than the original size. Will Java appear an error and no change in the length of the elements in an if statement? I'm not quite getting the question. So the temporary array size is double the length of the original array. So it's bigger. Can you go over the highlighted section again? Yes. So the push method takes an integer. I want to put it in the stack. But if my size of the stack is greater, basically if it's equal, greater than equal with the length of the array elements, that means that I don't have any more space to put my integer value. So for that, first thing before I put it in the stack, I basically duplicate, I create a new array temp of double the number of locations. Then I copy the elements from the old array into the new array, one by one, starting element at index 0, from elements to temp at 0, and so on for all the elements in the original array, elements.length. Once I copied all the elements from the original array to the new array, elements is assigned temp. So basically, elements is assigned temp. So the elements is now redirected to the temporary array. Now, once I have a bigger array, I can assign to elements of size the value that was passed as a parameter. And I can increment, post increment the size with 1. Now, Mingxi is asking, elements smaller length equal temp, larger size, does it work? Yes, I basically can copy from a smaller array into a bigger array. Yeah. So that is something that is possible. So if I have, I will demonstrate to you here, if I have an integer array x, and x contains 3 values, 1, 2, 3, and I have an integer array y is equal with a new integer array of 6, basically bigger array, I can do system.array copy of from x starting from index 0 into y starting from index 0, and the number of elements is x.length. So now if I look at the first 3 elements of y, like for instance, for every integer i starting from 0, I less than 3, I plus plus, system.out.println the value of y of I, it will basically show that I copied 1, 2, 3 from the array x into the array y. Okay, so for the null part, I ignore it. Like I only iterate up to the size, okay? So null parts are not changed. No, they are not. They are still null. then the size is post incremented with value with, after the value is assigned. Yeah. So if I copied here those elements and now I want y of the next element, which is 3, be assigned 4, that's totally fine. I can now iterate up to 4 and print the elements 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's exactly what's happening. I'm creating an array of double the size. I copy the old elements and I basically get the new array. In fact, I could have now done before, even before this, I could have just said X is now redirected to Y. And from now on, X is the array of 6 elements. Okay. So I use X here. This is exactly what we are doing, but in an abstract fashion. Basically, I create a bigger array. I copy the elements from the old array into the new array. I redirect X to the new array. And now I can use X as an array of double the size. Any questions? Okay. That's it for today. We are out of time. So we stopped at slide 19 and we'll continue with strings next class. Thank you very much. See you on Thursday.
Thank you, Professor.
Professor, have a good day.
You too, bye.